This is Recovery on AiR from Aberdeen in Recovery. Good afternoon, and a very warm welcome to Recovery on AiR on shmu 99.8 FM. My name is John, delighted to have your company this afternoon. And in the mix of music and chat for today, the conversation will be all about SMART goals. Now, you may well be wondering, what is a SMART goal? What makes a SMART goal smart? And how do we implement a SMART goal in our lives? Well, I can tell you all of these mysteries will be revealed over the course of the next hour, so please do stay with us. And I'm joined today by Alan and Stevie from Aberdeen in Recovery, and also joining us today and making her return to Recovery on AiR, it is my very great pleasure to welcome back Lindsay.
Thank you, John. Thank you.
So it's great to have you back. And well, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. Yeah, it's been a while, and nerves have crept in again. Funnily enough, I'm not used to it. It's been over a year, I think. Well, coming up a year. So yeah, it's good to be back and good to see all you guys. And I'm excited to chat about SMART goals. Thank you.
Sounds great. Yeah, well, I understand the nerves thing. I have that every time. Stevie, how are you doing?
I'm fine, John. Thank you. Looking forward to doing a radio today. And I did a radio show for a little while. So be good. Ready to go.
Sounds good. Yeah. Alan, how are you?
Hi, John. Yes, I'm really good and really excited about getting the show back on the road again and getting going again. Yes, really looking forward. Thank you, John. And how are you, John?
Oh, I'm not bad. Thank you very much. And yeah, looking forward to the show as well. But before we get into the conversation, well, we're going to get things started with a bit of music. And this first tune, it takes us back in time a little bit to an earlier era of radio. This is AM Radio by Everclear.
Things changed back in 75. We were all growing up on the in and the outside. Christmas Day. I dream that Jimmy Pitt will come and say, I'm gonna come.
Welcome back to FM radio. That was AM radio by Everclear. So today we're talking about SMART goals. And well, I guess the best way to begin is, well, Alan, what exactly is a SMART goal?
Well, John, I shall try my best to give you a bit of understanding about what SMART goals are. I'll try to make it as short and brief and hopefully a bit everybody will have a bit of understanding about what SMART goals are. Like, what are goals to start with? Goals. Goals are targets that individuals aim to achieve, and planning is about discussing options and deciding on the best way to support yourself. When deciding on goals, people should set SMART goals. They should be specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time-framed. If goals are specific, measurable, and achievable, it is more likely that the individual will be motivated to keep working to succeed. If the goals are unrealistic, with no real way to measure success, then people involved wouldn't be able to tell if they are making any progress towards their goals. A short-term goal is a step towards a long-term goal. I'll give you an example. Just for example, say Jimmy. Jimmy is overweight and he's wanting to lose some weight. So for Jimmy, a long-term goal for Jimmy, it might be to say lose 50 kilograms over a year. However, this is a long time to wait to see if there is any change in Jimmy's weight and to be able to evaluate whether the things he is doing to achieve this change are working. And even a a year, as I say, that's a long time to wait to find out. And it's like you could turn out in the end of that year and say, well, I'm still the same weight, so it didn't work. And so by setting a number of short-term goals, Jimmy can work towards that long-term goal and his progress can be monitored. It wouldn't be very smart to say Jimmy should lose some weight. How would this be measured? Instead, a SMART goal for Jimmy would be to lose, say, 4 kilograms in a month. This is specific, it is measurable, it is achievable, and it is realistic. And it's also time-framed because you're saying a month. So this kind of goal is easily measured by yourself, and it is objective, because anyway, if he wears his cell in a month, you'll care whether or not his goal's achievable and it's working for his day. So this is an objective measure of progress. It is not dependent on what someone thinks or feels, which would be subjective and not smart. So in a nutshell, that is exactly what a SMART goal is. It's something, it is specific, it is measurable, it's achievable, it's realistic, and it's time framed. So I hope that helps all you lovely people out there. I hope this helps you to achieve in your goals in the future. So with that, I shall hand back to John.
Well, that certainly helped me. And thanks very much for that. I think that's a brilliant introduction. And I think it's time to pause for another piece of music. So this next tune is Cast No Shadow by Oasis.
For every man who tries to understand what is in his You're listening to Recovery On Air at shmu 99.8 FM. Recovery, a journey of discovery.
And welcome back. And that was Cast No Shadow by Oasis. And so we've been talking about SMART goals today. And Lindsay, you've got something to say.
Yeah, just to pick up on what Alan was talking about in the first bit there. I think that's really important, Alan, what you were saying about breaking bigger tasks down. It's so easy to get overwhelmed when, you know, you set goals that are mammoth, or even if they're not, in your own mind, they can be absolutely enormous. And you just think, I'm never going to make that. I'm never going to manage that. Whether it's big in the sense of the job itself, for example, I badly need to decorate my house. I mean, decorating a house, it's just nonsense. You know, even the thought of that, you don't even open a tin of paint. It's like, it's not happening, a whole house. But, you know, breaking it down into littler bits, I'll paint the living room window, for example, by next week. And it makes it much more, you know, easier to get your head around. And then also the enormity of time scale, like your example at the start, Alan, about a year. You know, when you set out to do goals, and it's funny because we always talk about goals in the sense of they're an effort. You know, we always seem to speak about SMART goals and things that are going to be an effort and that you're not particularly motivated to do. Because I think if, you know, we want to go and do something, then we'll just go and do it without even thinking about it. So yeah, a year to seek some kind of progress, that's far too long. So again, yeah, breaking it down into littler chunks, whether it's the task itself into smaller bites, or whether it's in the time frame to make it a shorter time frame so you can actually see progress. I think to quote Dermot, one of his good sayings was, you know, you can't eat a whole elephant. You've got to break it down into little chunks, and then eventually you will get through it. So that's really, really good advice. Yep.
Yeah, and sometimes it's, you just don't know where to start. You know, when you've got so many things that are intertwined, you need to do this thing. But before you can do that thing, you have to do this other thing. And sometimes it can just be, well, just do something.
That's it.
And, yeah.
And yeah, totally. It's so easy to put things off again. Often when we speak about these things, it's about stuff that we don't really want to do or we're not overly motivated to do. So, from the queen of procrastination, I can always find something else to do before I'll do that thing that's been needing done for so long. But yeah, definitely it's just take a jump, take a leap and do something. And often it's the starting is the most difficult part. Back to my decorating, you know, if I just cracked open a tin of paint, I would motor through and it would be fine. But yeah, starting it. And I suppose that's something, you know, we can set the SMART goals, but it's getting that motivation to start can be difficult. I don't know if that's something that anybody's got a bit of advice. How do you start something that you really don't want to do? Just put everyone on the spot now.
Oh, I think that's one for Alan. He's looking like he has the answer.
Well, for myself personally, it's as we say, you've got to be really wanting to do it. You've got to be motivated. Like coming at your recovery, for me, I had to be motivated. It had to come from within. It came from my heart. I wanted to do this. I needed to do this. And it's the same for me. If I get from up, what motivates me, if I want to do something, well, it's got to be done. And I'm doing it for me. I've got to give myself a good shake and just say, right, let's get going. Let's get going. And okay, I might take, as I say, I'll just a little, as we say, just a little step to start with. Okay, I'll do a little bit. I'll maybe stop here, a cup of tea and a fancy piece. Then I'll get back into it again. And I keep, yes, we, as we're saying, a lot of things, we don't have to do it there and then and get it all done right away. As we say, just that little steps, break it down in little, easy, simple steps and just work my way through. Just, yes, and just once you get a little bit done, yeah, oh, I've managed that. That's an achievement. Yes, I can do this. Yes, so you do another little bit and that makes you even feel better. And it helps you build up that confidence and your self-esteem. And yes, I can do this. So by, as we say, just by setting that little wee, little goals to start with, that little step is just to work my way, just slowly along. And then by the end of time, that little step has become, gee whiz, it's, you cannot turn to see it now, it's gone. And that's starting with that little steps. And that's how I do it. Aye, just little steps.
That's a good thing, actually. It just popped into my head there when you were speaking as well. Well, it was actually as soon as you mentioned a cup of tea and a fancy piece. I was sold. You know, that's actually a really good motivator as well. If you maybe set yourself, you know, your little treat. We don't treat ourselves often enough, I don't think. And perhaps that's a motivator. Okay, if I do that bit, and then I'll reward myself with, yeah, a cup of coffee and a fancy piece. I would start anything for a cup of coffee and a fancy piece, I think. On that note.
Well, is that a good time to pause for a piece of music? This next tune, it's Dream Catch Me by Newton Faulkner.
I won't be anyone I wanna be, but it is.
listening to Recovery on Air at shmu 99.8 FM. Recovery, a journey of discovery. Welcome back. And that was Newton Faulkner with Dream Catch Me. So we've been talking about SMART goals and how important it is when you have a really big goal, big task, to break it down and not only make it into smaller, more achievable goals, but when you do achieve one of those smaller goals, to really give yourself credit for that, you know, savor that victory.
Yep, totally. And it is about those little rewards, as I said before the break there, you know, we don't reward ourselves enough. And Alan sort of touched on it as well before, you know, it's a real confidence booster. I think probably lack of motivation as well comes from a place where you're not feeling very good about yourself, you're not interested in match, your motivation levels are so low, it takes you all your time to get up in the morning, you know. But when you do, I mean, even that in itself, setting yourself, right, I'm going to get up before X time tomorrow. It's measurable, it's achievable, it's specific, it's time bound. You know, even that as a goal is so achievable. And when you do, it does. It gives you a massive confidence boost. It makes you feel so much better about yourself that you've actually done something, you've achieved something. And those feelings then help sort of spur you on. Okay, I done that. That wasn't too bad. That was actually pretty easy. I'm going to do it the same again tomorrow or next week or, you know, whatever it may be. But the confidence that you get from achieving something, and as you say, John, you know, giving yourself a bit of credit for that. I think as well, often we get caught up in the, oh, it's easy for that person. Why am I finding it so difficult? But I think it's important to understand that we're all different. We all find things, you know, some things easy, we all find some things difficult. And if things that you find particularly difficult, if you set that as a goal and a SMART goal, then you're going to achieve it. And often it's not quite as bad as what you've maybe built up in your head. Does that make sense?
Yes, Lindsay.
Yeah, absolutely.
That makes perfect sense. If I was going to say, just to follow on for Lindsay, as you said, again, we're all different. We're all unique individuals. And as you said, one thing might be easy for somebody and it might not be so easy for the next person. And it is a lot harder for some people. But as you say, if we give ourselves a big pat on the back, yes, I've done this. Yes, I have achieved it. I've done it. Whatever it is, even if you think it's maybe some person, individual might think it's nothing. It's too easy for them. But for you, it is a big, massive step. It's a big achievement. So we should be able to give ourselves a partner back. Yes, I've done that. Then I can do this. Yes. And just say yourself, okay, well done. And as you say, reward yourself with a cup of tea, cup of coffee, and a fancy piece. Aye, you deserve it. You deserve it. And I could, again, I've got set myself a lot of goals in my recovery. And one of them was actually, I didn't even think about it, was to start with, but it was just when I was going to my meetings and seeing how people could facilitate the meetings and how they had so much knowledge. I was just in awe. Again, it was the workers, senior workers. And then that's when it started to, it took a while just to sink into myself. But that was one of my goals, was to be in a position where I could support people in their recovery. And that's how I went and found out about it. And it took a lot of years, but it was one of my big, well, SMART goals. I used the SMART goals and how to achieve that. And like going to college, going to university, just fitting everything in, good, like finding out about finances and bursaries and things like that. And of course, at my more mature age as well. And I had all that, the things to think about and everything. But I knew it would be difficult for me going back to college and that, since I left the school in 19, blah, blah, blah. And but and that was one, again, it's things that you've got to think about. Well, I had to think about, was it realistic? And I says, well, yes, why not? And again, I've got the opportunity. I would only regret not even trying. If I'd tried and never got in, well, fair enough. At least I tried. And we can't say anything if we, again, it's okay if we don't try. Again, say, well, again, that's, I didn't bother trying. But if you try, then, well, I was lucky enough. Well, I got in, but I did all my preparations. I found out about, got advice for a lot of different people. And that was, again, just as I said, just taking out little steps, finding out what I needed to achieve it. And I knew it was, it was a time limit as well, because you had to have your application in before a certain date. So I had that date to work to, and I just set everything else in place, and I just worked along, and I got to college. So it was a big goal for me, but I used all that little steps, little goals in between to achieve that bigger goal.
I think that's a great example as well, Alan. Like you say, it's, you know, the original thought of, right, that's what I want to do. That's what I want to learn to do that. I mean, that is a mammoth task. But you broke that right down and probably had 100, if not more, SMART goals between that first meeting and where you are, you know, today, and all that steps that you did to get there. And you just mentioned something there as well that I wanted to sort of pick up on. If you don't try, you know, it's you're going to regret not trying. And I think something to be mindful of while we're talking about this is the failure part. We are going to fail at stuff. We are going to set targets and miss them. And I think it's really important to understand that, you know, that's okay. That's okay to fail. And sometimes it is just the trying part that you need to do to get there, because it'll often take you in a different direction anyway, you know, when you're setting out those massive goals. But yeah, I think it's just to be mindful of it. It is okay to miss a target. We could maybe pick that back up.
Yes, absolutely. I think that's an excellent point. You know, really, you learn more through through failing, which may sound strange, but anyway, we'll pick up with this conversation after another piece of music. This next tune, it's for Alan, a big fan of Madness, and it's Our House.
Where's his Sunday best? Mother's tired, she needs a rest. The kids are playing up downstairs. Sister's sighing in her sleep. Brother's got a date to keep, he can't hang around. Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our house, it has a crowd. There's always something happening, and it's usually quite loud. Our mum, she's so house proud. Nothing ever slows her down, and a mess is not allowed. Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our street.
Something tells you that you've got to make
in the middle of our street.
gets up late for work. Mother has to iron his shirt. Then she sends the kids to school. Sees them off with a small kiss. She's the one they're going to miss in lots of ways.
Simply waste a day away, then we'd say nothing would come between us. Two dreamers. Father wears his Sunday best. Mother's tired, she needs a rest. The kids are playing up downstairs. Sister's sighing in her sleep. Brother's got a date to keep, he can't hang around.
Listening to Recovery on Air at shmu 99.8 FM. Recovery, a journey of discovery.
Welcome back, and that was Madness with Our House. Great tune, Alan. Thanks very much for that. And so we were talking about, well, of course, SMART goals and how sometimes we learn more from failure, as much as that might sound paradoxical. We learn more from failure than we do from success, and that can help us to set a new goal, maybe more realistic, and achieve that.
Absolutely. And do you know what? I thought this was a perfect quote. It was something I heard a couple of years ago now. It was actually David Coulthard. And I wrote it down and it's stuck in my head ever since. But he said something during a Formula One, and he said success is a lousy teacher. And I thought that was absolutely perfect.
That's excellent. Yeah, love that.
It's just stuck with me since I heard it. And it's so true. If we continually succeed, we don't know how to fail. And I think, you know, we do learn more from failure, whether it's, we're setting goals that are unrealistic. But do you know what? We're not all good at everything all of the time. And I think, you know, that's part of the human condition, isn't it? It's not that we're maybe bad at stuff. It's just we're not as good as some others. So, you know, we need to understand our limitations. And often, you know, without going into a completely different topic, but, you know, without those sort of things, you know, it's those things that keep us safe. It's understanding our limitations. That's what keeps us safe, ultimately. But that could veer off into a whole different direction, and we're far too far into a radio show to go in there. But we definitely learn more from failure, John, and we learn more about ourselves. And I think particularly when it comes to goal setting, we need to understand ourselves. Not that we should intentionally go out and try and fail at stuff to force the lesson. It doesn't quite work like that. But I'm rambling now.
Can I just pick up on what Lindsay was saying there about failures? But as well, like, as we say, again, if you fail at something, that doesn't mean I'm never going to be able to do something. I'm useless. Oh, I'm rubbish. I'll never be able to do anything. Well, like, here's another example. I'll give you another example. I didn't pass my driving test till, a second attempt. I failed the first time, but I didn't just say, oh, that's it, I'll never be able to drive. Oh, I pop me this, that's it, I'll give up, I've never got to drive, and that's it. But no, I went back, I got more lessons, got myself more confident again and my self-esteem. Yes, I can do this. Aye. Okay. So I went and took my test again and I passed it a second time. So as we said, again, if we don't pass first time, if we didn't get it right first time, it's not just a simple thing that, oh, that's it, and just give up. I'll just give up. No, you keep, again, give it a go. Keep trying. Keep going for it. Yes.
And
yes.
Aye, sorry, Alan. Yeah, it's that if at first you don't succeed, try again. And another quote popped into my head. This time it's Thomas Edison, actually. And who'd have thought David Coulthard and Thomas Edison in the same show? Anyway, he said something along the lines of, I can't remember the figure, but it was when he was inventing the light bulb, and he said he didn't fail 30,000 times. He just found 30,000 ways not to make a light bulb. And I thought that was a really cool way to put a spin, you know, a different spin on it. It's not failing that many times. It's just, it's how not to do it.
that's excellent.
Yeah. So yeah, it's and obviously, you know, everything, we laugh about things, and I think as well, we've got to laugh and yeah, as Alan was saying, you know, if you fail the first time, it doesn't mean that's game over. You just pick yourself up, dust yourself off and go, right, okay. So that's, and Thomas Edison in mind, you know, okay, so I don't do it that way, I'll try something else. That can be a really useful mindset, particularly if you're trying to negotiate a goal that perhaps you do lack a bit of knowledge or lack a bit of understanding. Then you make sure you go and, you know, if you don't succeed the first time, you go and learn, and make sure that you nail it the second or third or fourth or sixth or, you know, however many times. It's again, it's back to almost full circle what we were talking about at the start. If it's something that you want to do, you'll make sure you do it somehow, and you will battle through it. Yeah, you take the learning from that, and Stevie just mentioned there, you take the learning from that failure and apply it to the next time round. Another thing just popped into my head, racing now. The Mr. Bean episode when he was painting, I keep thinking, coming back to my decorating, he throws the do you remember it? The heap of fireworks in a tin of paint? Obviously, that's not something that you do, by the way. If anyone's listening there and they think that's a good idea, it ain't. But it has gone through my head, thinking, yeah, is that one way to paint my house? It's quick.
We do not endorse that.
No, we don't. No, make that very clear. Health warning, please do not try this at home. Oh, my head's going wild. It's so good to be back.
It's wonderful to have you, wonderful to have you back.
Yeah. David Coulthard, Thomas Edison, and Mr. Bean. Who the funk?
My goodness.
Yeah, so yeah, glad to be back. Anyway, sorry, Stevie, you were saying something there. You're mic'd up now, so do you wanna?
Yeah, I just know by setting, when I first started a couple of years ago, getting told about setting goals and stuff, once I'd reached the little goal that I set, maybe like getting up, having a shower, making my bed, eating breakfast, I felt like I succeeded. I did positive things, so that then let me set other goals. And then once I got to them, I set other goals. And it is just setting little goals, because I kind of like to set a big goal and not manage it, and how horrible you feel about yourself because you've set too big a goal or you've not managed to reach the goal. So I go out, like, for mental health and stuff, going out for a walk, being around positive people, reducing meds, just taking care of yourself.
Yeah, that's excellent. I think that's a great way to sort of round up as well, Stevie. It's, you know, even forming new habits like what you're speaking about, you know, break them into SMART goals and just try and tackle one thing at a time.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, it'll compound and you'll be running before you know it, for sure.
Well, thanks very much to everyone joining us today. That's been a really important talk. I think, well, certainly I've gained a lot from it. And I'm afraid we're pretty much out of time. So it's just into the contact details. So if you would like to learn more about Aberdeen and Recovery, who we are and what we do, you'll find the very latest, best information on our website. And that's www.aberdeenandrecovery.org. You can follow us on social media. On Twitter and Instagram, we are Republic_AiR. And on Facebook, we are Aberdeen in Recovery. You can catch up with previous episodes of Recovery on AiR on our YouTube channel. Just head along to YouTube and search on Aberdeen in Recovery. Our channel will top the list. We'd love to hear from you. Of course, we always love to hear from you. And you can contact us through social media or give us a call on 01224-638-342. Or drop us an email, and that's chatterbox@aberdeenandrecovery.org. If anyone out there is in need of more urgent advice, please contact Alcohol and Drugs Action Helpline. It's a free phone number, and that's 0333-344-8355. And that number again, it's 0333-344-8355. And a couple of other helpful numbers. There's Alcoholics Anonymous at 0800-917-7650 and Narcotics Anonymous, and that's 0300-999-1212. So that's goodbye from us for now. Thank you very much for listening, and please do join us again next week. That's Thursday, 2 p.m. for Recovery on AiR, right here on shmu, 99.8 FM. And finally, to play us out this week, it's the Skydiggers with Just Over This Mountain.